Hayward Fault, another geological big one coming. A series of 7 earthquakes recently shook California, sparking fears that the big one could be imminent. But this time, it's not about the San Andreas Fault. According to the United States Geological Survey, the USGS, the strongest earthquake to hit California recently was a magnitude 4.3, which struck about 9.7 kilometers or 6 miles north-northwest of Avenal at approximately 4:17 p.m. on February 13th. Later that same afternoon, 3 earthquakes were recorded just 1 mile or about 1.5 kilometers from Hayward in California's Bay Area. 2 of these tremors occurred just 2 minutes apart. All 3 happened along the Hayward Fault, which the USGS notes is an active fault in the San Francisco Bay region. Their magnitudes measured 3.2, 3.3, and 2.6, respectively. To top it off, a magnitude 3.9 earthquake rocked the entire Bay Area on March 17th. The USGS reported that this quake originated in Dublin, west of the Calaveras Fault, which has a direct connection to the Hayward Fault, potentially triggering larger earthquakes in the East Bay. By now, some of you may be wondering, the Hayward Fault? Where did that come from? And why is it being flagged as a source of a major future risk? No worries, this video will provide all the information you need to understand why experts have been increasingly focused on this fault, which until now has flown under the radar for many. So stay tuned. The Hayward Fault is one of California's most significant and potentially dangerous geological features. A scar stretching about 119 kilometers or roughly 74 miles along the western base of the hills on the east side of the San Francisco Bay. It cuts through densely populated areas, including Richmond, El Cerrito, Berkeley, Oakland, San Leandro, Castro Valley, Hayward, Union City, Fremont, and San Jose. Often overshadowed by its more famous cousin, the San Andreas Fault, anyone living in the Bay Area should know it well, very well. In fact, especially because this fault slices through some of the most heavily populated zones in Northern California, literally splitting cities like Fremont, Hayward, from which it takes its name, Oakland, Berkeley, Richmond, and San Pablo in two. It's as if a sleeping giant has stretched itself across the East Bay, and now millions of people live, work, and play atop this slumbering titan. But we shouldn't be fooled by its current silence, because we've long known that this giant wakes periodically. And when it does, it shakes the earth with devastating force. To tell its story, we have to start far back, with the slow and relentless dance of tectonic plates. And it's precisely this movement that generates earthquakes. The Pacific plate shifts northwestward at a rate of 5 to 6 centimeters, or about 2 to 2.4 inches per year, a speed that might seem insignificant when compared to our daily lives. But geologically speaking, it's as if these plates were sprinting through a marathon. Along the Hayward Fault, however, this motion isn't uniform. Some sections slide gradually and continuously, a phenomenon known as aseismic creep, while others remain locked for decades or even centuries, building tension like a compressed spring. When the lock segments finally give way, they release all that accumulated energy in a single instant, generating earthquakes that can range from mild tremors to devastating quakes. In short, the Pacific plate glides northwest, while the North American plate resists, a battle of two giants locked in a distorted waltz. And in the middle of this titanic struggle lies a web of faults that discharge the accumulated energy. The Hayward Fault is one of these, a younger sibling to the San Andreas, but infinitely more treacherous because it snakes directly beneath the foundations of a metropolis. On October 21, 1868, when the Bay Area was little more than a collection of farms and dusty small towns, a magnitude 7.0 earthquake ripped through the earth from Fremont to Berkeley. It leveled every brick building in its path, opened fissures so deep that, as some accounts report, horses fell into them, and left a scar that, if you know where to look, is still visible today. In the crooked walls of Victorian houses, in the warped sidewalks of Hayward, and in the patched asphalt strips of Fremont that resemble scars on the city's skin. Fortunately, the death toll was relatively low, around 30 people, but this was largely due to the sparse population at the time. If a similar event were to happen today, the consequences would likely be catastrophic. That event was so powerful that for decades, it was called the Great San Francisco Earthquake, until the monster of the San Andreas Fault stole the title in 1906. But here's the point. The Hayward Fault has never stopped accumulating stress, inching, creeping, millimeter by millimeter, year after year, while above it, skyscrapers, highways, hospitals, and universities have risen. And it was, after all, the devastating 1906 San Francisco earthquake that convinced many residents to rush to the East Bay, mistakenly believing it to be safer. This led to a construction boom in cities like Oakland, Berkeley, and the surrounding communities, with many buildings erected directly atop the fault or dangerously close to it. And so, every day as you sip your coffee in Berkeley or jog along Lake Merritt, the fault beneath your feet breathes, twists, and accumulates energy like a compressed spring. Geologists have calculated that since 1868, the accumulated slip deficit, the amount of movement that should have been released in an earthquake, has reached about 2.5 meters, or roughly 8.2 feet. 2.5 meters of tension ready to unleash in a matter of seconds, with a force that could exceed magnitude 7. And this isn't speculation, it's mathematics. The fault follows an average seismic cycle of about 140 years, with 5 major events occurring between 1315 and 1868, each at intervals of 140 to 160 years. And now, 157 years have already passed since the last one. It's as if we've gone past the expiration date on a ticking time bomb, and the clock is growing louder. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You'll help us to make products of even higher quality. But it gets worse. In 2016, seismic studies discovered that the Hayward Fault is no longer alone. It has merged with the Rogers Creek Fault beneath San Pablo Bay, forming a single 190-kilometer, or about 118-mile system, capable of generating an earthquake up to a magnitude 7.4. This is a completely different beast, one that could simultaneously shake Santa Rosa and San Jose, collapse twice as many bridges, and double the landslides in the Berkeley Hills. And as if that weren't enough, suspicious studies of micro-earthquakes suggest that to the south, beneath San Jose, the Hayward Fault might also be connected to the Calaveras Fault, creating an even larger monster. A kind of tectonic Godzilla ready to awake with a quake that could approach magnitude 7.8. Now put yourself in the shoes of an East Bay resident. You're living on top of a fault that could rupture tomorrow or 10 years from now. But when it does, it will be a hellish symphony of seismic waves amplified by the soft soils of the bay. This waterlogged clay left by ancient tides will behave like jelly under stress, liquefying building foundations, swallowing roads, and distorting gas pipelines. Think of Interstate 80, the elevated highway built in the 1930s on unstable ground. During a major quake, that concrete ribbon could sink into the mud, blocking access to the Bay Bridge for months and paralyzing freight traffic from the Port of Oakland, which alone handles 99% of Northern California's container traffic. Imagine the Chevron pipelines in Richmond, those that carry natural gas and oil, snapping like toothpicks, igniting fires impossible to extinguish because the aqueduct supplying water to 800,000 people could be severed by the fault in dozens of places, leaving firefighters to battle the flames with buckets and bottled water. And what about the subway system that carries 500,000 passengers daily through the Transbay Tube? The underwater tunnel that, during the 1989 Loma Prieta earthquake, nearly floated away due to destabilized mud. They've reinforced it since then, but the tunnel still crosses the fault, and in the event of a rupture, thousands of people could be trapped underwater in a nightmarish scene straight out of a disaster movie. And then there are the details that send shivers down your spine. Did you know that Berkeley's Memorial Stadium has been divided into 4 independent sections because the fault runs directly beneath the field? And the columns of the stands have already shifted by 33 centimeters or about 13 inches due to creep? Or that in Fremont, you can see firsthand how the curbs of a downtown parking lot have been warped by underground pressure, as though a giant hand stomped on the asphalt. Speaking of curbs, it seems that in Hayward, a road repair crew unintentionally destroyed one of the systems most cherished by California seismologists for tracking the fault's progress. By periodically measuring the displacement of a sidewalk curb, geologists could get an empirical but sufficiently accurate idea of the fault's creep. However, the Hayward City Administration wasn't aware of the curb's importance and last June began work to fix it and add a wheelchair ramp, which involved realigning the entire curb. I wouldn't trust such administrations too much. To close out the list of looming clouds on the horizon, did you know that USGS liquefaction maps show entire neighborhoods from Marina Bay to San Leandro, from Alameda to Redwood City, are built on soils that would behave like quicksand during an earthquake, swallowing homes, cars, and people? Terrifying. But the real tragedy is that despite all these warnings, public preparedness is minimal. Yes, there are volunteer teams trained to assist neighbors, and many new buildings are constructed to seismic standards. But the majority of structures, especially older ones, made of unreinforced brick with weak foundations, are like bombs ready to go off. Think of the Victorian homes in San Francisco, garages converted into dwellings, schools built before the 1970s. In a strong quake, they would collapse like a house of cards, burying anyone inside. And even if by some miracle you survive the earthquake, you'll face the post-quake apocalypse. No electricity for weeks, transformers popping like popcorn, no running water, broken pipes, no gas, leaks everywhere sparking fires, no cell phones, towers either toppled or overloaded, looted supermarkets, shuttered pharmacies, streets blocked by rubble, and abandoned cars. As for the rescue efforts, even the hospitals themselves will be crippled. The Highland Hospital in Oakland, the main trauma center in the area, has wings built before seismic standards and could collapse just when it's needed most. And even if state aid arrives, it could take days, maybe weeks, to reach everyone, leaving millions to fend for themselves amid injuries, fires, and aftershocks. And let's not forget the economic impact. $1.5 trillion worth of property at risk. Damages estimated at up to $165 billion just for replicating the 1868 quake, let alone a magnitude 7.4, and a domino effect on the global economy, given that Silicon Valley, with its data centers and microchip factories, could go offline for months, paralyzing industries ranging from finance to entertainment. In short, the Hayward Fault reminds us that we live on a planet that's alive, dynamic, and indifferent to our plans. Geologists monitor it night and day with seismometers, GPS systems, and lasers measuring millimeter rock displacement. But in the end, we cannot predict when it will strike. All we can do is prepare, reinforce buildings, always have emergency kits on hand, teach children to shelter under desks, and hope that when the big one comes, we'll be ready to rebuild as our ancestors did in 1868, constructing anew on the same cracks. Because that's how life on a fault works. A fragile balance between fear and resilience, destruction and rebirth. Meanwhile, the years tick by like a countdown. Will it happen this month, next year, or in 10 years? They say the stress shadow created by the 1906 San Francisco earthquake may have delayed the Hayward Fault seismic activity, draining much of its energy, and this could explain why the big one on Hayward is slightly overdue. But even the extra time we've been gifted may be running out, so we must reflect quickly on what we can and cannot do to protect ourselves and those around us.